and an expert wrangler of the dachshunds that have roamed Dixter for decades. He is also author of the Hot Off the Presses Great Dixter Cookbook, which brings to the page the spirit of warm hospitality, seasonal food, and great gardening that were the hallmarks of Great Dixter in Christo's day, and remain so with Fergus Garrett at the helm. Knowledgeable gardeners rave about Dixter's rich history, great architectural bones, sophisticated and exuberant plant palette, and excellent horticulture. I am looking forward to hearing Aaron's perspective on edible Dixter, an aspect of the garden less well known to the general public, but celebrated by those fortunate enough to be part of the extended Dixter family that gathers together regularly, maybe too regularly, for meals, drink, and conversation. Please join me in welcoming Aaron to the garden.
Well, it's nice to see so many people coming out to listen to me. It's always a compliment when you give a talk that someone wants to listen. So I'm going to give you a sort of overview of my gardening year. But beforehand, I just want to give you a little bit about the history of Great Dixter. This is the front entrance that you arrive at first at Dixter, and this is the turning point for a lot of people. This rough grass, unkept garden, and it's the moment where people think, I'm actually not going to pay to come into something like that. That doesn't look like it's had any love. But these meadows are very intentional and they have a rich history. These are the meadows of Christopher's mother, Daisy Lloyd, who was a follower of William Robinson, the great naturalist in Britain. And he moved away from that Victorian style and did this sort of thing. But it's a great test of turning people away who actually aren't interested in good gardening. The house is the centre of the garden. As you go around the house, you're going to go around the house. Everything from the porch to the right is medieval, dating from 1450 forward. And there's also a medieval barn off to the right. You can see in the photo there. There's the Oast House. There's the medieval barn. The original entrance was past the barn because in Britain, a great barn like that was a sign of wealth. So you got all your guests to go past and see all the cattle in the barn, and they knew they were coming somewhere special. Now they just go down a rough path. What we're looking at here, we're in the peacock garden. It's not a squirrel garden, it's a peacock garden. A lot of people seem to get it wrong. And we're looking onto Lutyens' extension to the house, Lutyens' wing. So we've got, I'm not very good at technology, I'm a gardener. We've got this medieval part here, we've got this Tudor hall here, and then all the rest here that joins the two halls together is a Lutyens' wing. And that gave the family a service area, bedrooms, and the servants' quarters up in the top of here. Lutyens originally wanted windows for the staff, but Lloyd didn't. He wanted that beautiful roofscape to go all along and blend the whole house together. They have got windows in the bedroom, and that's where we put the students now. And this is looking at more of this unkept garden, and looking up to the last part of the house, the Yeoman's Hall House. And this hall house was derelict. It was 10 miles away on a farm. And as Lloyd and Lutyens were touring around, they saw this hall, and they decided to purchase it off the farmer for £75, number the beams. The farmer did want to keep the tin roof, which was fine because they were going to put terracotta roof anyway, so it didn't matter too much, numbered all the beams and put it back up and made it livable. So that's the third part of the house. And this is looking from the topiary lawn up. This is the last part of the garden that Christopher introduced, the meadows. Christopher didn't like muscular people or any sport generally. And so the first thing he did was turn the tennis court into a car park. And his father's putting green was this area here, which he turned back into a meadow. And I think that was revenge from his childhood. Him and his mother were paid to get on their hands and knees and dig out any weeds growing in the fine turf. So Christopher got the last laugh. He planted a meadow. well, let a meadow develop. There was, the seed was in the ground anyway. So we've got this fantastic structure of Nathaniel's topiary pieces with the softness of the meadow. And that's looking from the roof down onto the peacock garden. Top right-hand corner is where the vegetable garden is. It's up in this area. So this is my commute every morning. I walk up through. I'm never late to work because I live on site. But it's not a bad commute. I get distracted quite easily. We've got also a rich history because the Lloyds were hoarders. There's friends in the audience, Vince, who can relate to this. But they kept everything, all the receipts from the development of Great Dixter over the years. And this is a seed catalogue from 1919 from Sutton Seeds. So it's very interesting to see the heritage of the development of the garden over the years. So these are very interesting to see. And as Americans, you don't understand the significance of this. This is a young boy holding a tomato, which you take for granted. In Britain, we don't take tomatoes fruiting for granted. We're always pleased to get a single tomato from our plants. And there's Patrick, Christopher's older brother, with probably maybe the only tomato of the season, but they got something off. So it's a great old photo of him up in the vegetable garden with a tomato. And there's Christopher. Christopher probably visited the vegetable garden. It was probably the part of the garden he visited most. He became a cook when his cook, Mrs. Cunningham, died in the 70s. He took over the kitchen. He decided not to employ another cook. He would do it himself. So he would go up there each day and pick from the garden. So there he is, walking up through the peacock garden with his basket. There he is, looking at the rows of kale doing their thing in front of him. And he's probably thinking about what he's going to do with this crop, how he'll use it in the kitchen. And there's the fruit cage in the background and the house. And Todd talked about the Dachshunds. The Dachshunds are the emblem of Great Dixter. The Queen has corgis, and all the great houses have different dogs. The Lloyds started with Spaniels, and Christopher in the 50s started getting Dachshunds. We have two biting Dachshunds still. Well, one biting Dachshund and one encouraging one to bite Dachshund. So I don't know what's worse. And in his basket, he's got some celeriac. So it's late winter, early spring. The raspberries are just starting to leaf up there. I've got another great asset at Great Dixter. That's Perry Rodriguez, who's now the business manager. And he was Christopher's vegetable garden. But if any of you actually garden, you'll know that the thing that goes quickly is your knees. So Perry got out into the office in the warmth before his knees went. And I took over the vegetable garden from him. And there he's got a corgi in the background. We're visiting a friend's garden. But he's a great resource for me with problems that occur in the garden. So, yes, I know, it has that effect, doesn't it? For me, the gardening year starts on the 1st of November. We close to the public. I'm always very sad to see the public leave. But it's a new start for me. It's a new year. I don't hold any religious holidays for New Year, but I do hold the 1st of November a gardening New Year. And you forget about the past. All those mistakes you made in the past, they're behind you. You can look forward and start thinking about things. And it's also a time to start doing something with your produce. We grow a lot more pumpkins at Great Dixter now, which you would probably find surprising because Americans seem to eat a lot of pumpkins. But in Britain, they were cattle food for a very long time. They were certainly something you wouldn't serve up to a guest. But we're growing a lot more now, and so you'll see more of those as you go along. We also store the fruit in the larder. The larder is open on the north side of the house, open to the elements. When the men came and rewired after 100 years of the same wiring, they had to wear ski suits when they rewired the larder. That's how cold it was. And they still talk about it today. It was 12 years ago. So some of the fruit is from Dixter. I must admit, a lot of the apples in this photo have actually stolen. There's a very good orchard down the road, but I don't pick them. I wait till they've put them in cases, and then I go and take them out of the cases. So I don't think it's so dishonest to if someone else has picked them. We'll also dry beans and things. These are bolotti beans. We dry for the winter to put into stews and that sort of thing. We just open them up and put them on the windowsill, let them dry out, and then put them in the jars for the winter season. And it's at this point I just want to point out, a lot of people come to these talks and say, well, it's you know, you can talk about living on a large estate, it's all very well for you. I live in a one-bedroom in Manhattan. You can grow things in pots. You've just got to scale to whatever works for you. I've traveled around the States a bit, and there's a lot of people doing a lot of interesting vegetable gardening on a very small scale. I was just at Chanticleer Gardens, and they're doing fantastic displays with the vegetables. So it's at this point that I just want to point out, you're going to see a lot of beautiful large estate, but there is, you have to scale it to whatever works for you. And you don't have to have a huge amount of money. You can see this photo, there's a plastic pot being used. They're not all Louis XIV Versailles pots. You can actually use plastic. As long as you hide it with a prettier plant or foliage in front, it's not too offensive for those of us who like to look at plants. And this is the kitchen yard. This we fill up with lots of herbs and vegetables in pots. And I also love pelargoniums. Well, I've kind of gone off pelargoniums, but I did love pelargoniums. And it's a very decorative space. It's a very small space, but it's got a lot of interest. And you'll notice that this self-sow is coming out of the brickwork. And that's a very much a Great Dixter thing. There's, you know, plants are allowed to self-sow in cracks. We don't get in there with weed sprays and kill them off. We let them do their thing. You wouldn't have this fantastic Verbascum olympicum in the flower if you use chemicals, because that's a self-sow. And we have every year children of these Verbascums pop up. So it's a long heritage of Verbascums in that particular brickwork. But this is what we want to do. We want to fill up the jam cupboard with jam. And this is a moment where you start thinking it's time to invite friends down for weekend parties, because a job shared is a job halved. All you've got to do is make sure you have enough booze in. They'll stay all weekend. They won't get the next train out when they see what they're doing. We do cook a lot of chutneys at Great Dixter, and what you'll see later on, we've got a photo of Daisy's ripe tomato chutney. We do beetroot chutneys, but we store them in these pots for the winter, and we'll eat them. Tomato chutney needs a little settling time. Beetroot chutney you can eat immediately. And the question I'm often asked is, what is my favourite vegetable? I don't know that I have, whatever's in season is probably my favourite vegetable, but I do enjoy beetroot. I think it's very versatile, good for you, and very good flavour. And we use it a lot throughout the year. This is a wine box full of seeds. This is the end of the autumn when the seed box is pretty much coming to the end. A lot of my seeds I import from the States. You've got a great selection, and I'm trying to go as much as I can with just organic seeds, because I think it's a good start to growing if you can use organics. So there's a lot more organic seeds I seem to be able to choose from over here. And I saw someone in the audience who had his notebook ready. I hope he'll use it today. But as a gardener, I think notebook is a key tool for your gardening. If you've got a memory like me, you're not going to remember when you turn around what they just told you the plant name was. So unless you write it down, you're not going to remember. It's also good when it's time to start ordering the seeds to remember what you had last year. So all I do is I have what the vegetable is, the variety, the date I sowed the seed, and which the seed supplier was. And if I don't like a vegetable, I just cross it out and I know not to get the seed next year. And there's my desk covered in catalogues and notebooks. The other problem is I have a travelling notebook and I have a seed sown notebook and another notebook. So it's a matter of tying them all together and remembering. Because, you know, when you travel, you see different plants you want to grow. So I just write them down. Because it's very easy as a gardener to open a catalogue and want everything. You can be quite greedy. So having some notes does kind of curb that problem. And then we'll just type out the list, and this is useful for people who want to know what we grow in at Great Dixter. I'm a terrible typist, I'm a one-finger typist. I'm too old to learn to touch type, like young people now. So I usually get a friend to type this out for me. Some of the seed catalogues are incredibly useful as far as giving you information. This is a Welsh seed company, the Real Seed Catalogue, and they give you information on how to sow the seed, but also how to collect the seed, which I think is slightly unusual because I don't know how long the business will last if they're giving you all the secrets in your packet of seed. But luckily, we use a lot of vegetables at Dixter, and so the greed takes over and we don't have any waste or chance of collecting seed. Tools. Every person, I think, in the room would consider a different tool to be their favourite. For me, these are the two tools that I find very useful. We've got this Japanese secateurs on the left and this titanium trowel on the right. It's worth £250, and I point this out because I certainly didn't pay that. It's forged in the Netherlands by a family, and the husband is quite hard businessman. But the woman's quite sweet, so I used all the charm I had for that year and charmed her when he left the room, and she gave me a set of three tools. And on retirement, I'll probably melt the titanium down and have my knees done. So I think it's a great investment for the future. I use these big tools here for different tasks. But the back one is a great spade for digging, and we've had to modernise that. Most English tools are quite short, and that your back will go after a winter of digging. So I've put a German handle on it now, and we measured it to work best for me, and it's a fantastic tool, and it makes the job much easier. These are the compost heaps. When the meadows are cut, all the meadow cuttings are collected up and made into these cubes of cuttings, and you need a ladder to climb up the compost heap to get the compost on. The great thing about them when they're this high is the Dachshunds can't get on there and eat the food waste. So it's Dachshund-friendly composting. I highly recommend it. They get very fat easily. And this is what we do with the old compost heaps. We grow pumpkins on them. There's the pumpkin growing on the heap, and this is the one we're adding to now. This is Dachshund unfriendly, because they can climb up those sides. But there's the pumpkins doing their thing, and they like it there because it gets warm, and they just spill over the edge, and they look very attractive. And it's interesting, it's the thing that people often remember a lot about Great Dixter is the compost heaps. And there's the dogs in action. Miscanthus is the one in there, and Conifer's waiting expectantly for any rats that Miscanthus finds. Conifer's the sensible one. She gets the young one to do the work, and she waits for the loot. So we break up the heaps early on, in the after the 1st of November, and this is what we want to get out. This rich organic matter, this dark organic matter, that we're going to put onto the soil and dig it in and get the soil ready for another year the following summer. The outside of the heaps don't generally break down. But this is very useful for those plants that aren't completely hardy for us. So there we'll put on things like the rhubarb, the artichokes, and the soft fruit. We'll use them as a mulch. By the end of the winter, they've broken down and either blown away or broken down and fed the soil. So it's a perfect combination and very useful. We use a very simple method. I'm not sure how many people know about this. We use something called a wheelbarrow. It has a wheel and you push it along. And we just fill that up and empty in these big clumps, spread it out, and you'll see the next shot. Miscanthus waiting for worms to be uncovered. She's my trusty assistant. And we just dig in this compost a spit deep and leave the clods just like this, open to the elements. And that way, if we get a lot of rain, which Britain isn't known for, it won't puddle the soil, it'll soak through. But as a gardener, this is what you want to go up to in the morning. A heavy frost on the clay soil, breaking it up, breaking up that organic matter and making the soil rich to plant on. And I try and get the digging done before Christmas. That's my sort of point of that's when it's all done, because the colder months, January and February, you want it like that, where it can just be left to break down. And we've still got crops doing well. We've got the leeks in the background, and the autumn raspberries have still got leaves on, but there's a good frost on the ground doing its thing for the soil. And I also, when it's raining and I don't want to get on the soil, then I'll get into the fruit cage and start pruning the summer raspberries. The autumn raspberries we cut to the ground, the summer ones we take off last year's fruiting wood. And this is what we want to see. The right-hand side is the area I've done. And what we're doing is we're cutting them off at the same height as the posts and tying them in. So the following year, you'll know that everything that is tied to this wire, there's two wires running along there and there. Everything that's tied to the wires, you're going to cut out the following year, because that's the fruited wood. And everything that's loose is the new wood. So you cut out the old wood first, like organizations seem to do, and put in the new young ones for next year's fruiting wood. We also do the same for gooseberries and the black currants, red currants, that sort of thing. We get in there and take out the wood. The gooseberries, we take out any wood over 3 years old. And we open them up. The black currants we spur back, and the raspberries we take out the old wood as well. And this is the effect we want to get from the gooseberries: young, clean, good-looking wood, and an open with a vase shape from it. And that allows your hand to get in when it's time to pick. If you have friends staying, get them to do it. They're very prickly. But you also want the light to get in there and get onto the fruit, so it ripens. And the thing that I find most difficult, the problem area we have is bindweed. And we just have it in amongst the autumn raspberries, so I lift them every year, and year on year we've pretty much cleared it out, but it was very bad originally. I mean, the problem is it looks very pretty in the autumn with these big white flowers, but it really does weaken a crop. So we have to lift the plants, tease the roots out, take all the bindweed out. I haven't yet trained the Dachshunds to develop a taste for bindweed roots, but it would make life much easier for me. We also lift the sorrel. This is a French sorrel, which makes fantastic soup. And we lift it up because it's a perennial. Perennials, what they really want to do is they want to set seed. That's their main goal in life. And lifting them up, putting organic matter into the soil and replanting them helps stop them doing that, because they feel they're not under stress. They don't need to run to seed. We'll also cover them in a little cover for the winter, so they keep giving leaves and we can have some greens in the winter. Woodwork, it's probably my least, I'm probably the worst woodworker you'll ever meet. When I was younger and at school, we had to do 1 year of woodwork. My teacher took over my project and was relieved when I finished the year. I'm so hopeless. But we do try and clean up these labels, and we have these at the end of the row. You'll see later on these labels. It's chestnut, it's off-cut chestnut from our woodland, which we make into these little labels at the ends of each row. But each winter they can be cleaned up in the winter when it's raining. But now's the time to go off to Israel and have some blue sky. This is what I like to do for a couple of weeks every year. And this is what I want to see: something different, something exotic, and some blue sky. And then it's time to come back to reality and chip your potatoes. It's often a hard landing from Israel back to Great Dixter, but it's got to be done. So these are the potatoes on the windowsill at Great Dixter, outside my bedroom. So the first thing I see when I open the door in the morning is chitting potatoes. We grow three different varieties. We grow pink fir apple, which was Christopher's favorite, and it's a great storing potato to store. Picasso, which we have as a baking potato, and Charlotte as a salad potato. And Charlotte doesn't do well once she's out of the ground. The best thing is to get it out and cook it immediately. But what I found this winter is I left her in the ground the whole winter, and we've been eating straight from the ground, and they've done well. The slugs haven't realised what I'm up to, so haven't eaten them all. So it's been great to be able to have some still in the ground through the winter. We collect a lot of seed at Great Dixter, mostly from the perennial, and we sell them down in the nursery later on. So there they are, at the bottom of the staircase, in their little packets. But I get in most of my seed every year, and this is the Natural Gardening Company, great company for seeds, and it's, sowing lettuce seeds. And this is happening as I speak, well, probably not as I speak, but it's going on in England right now. I've imported an Australian to do the work while I'm away. He loves the Dachshund, so that was the criteria, but he's also quite good at the gardening. So he's getting that all done now, because this is the busiest time for us as far as getting plants in the ground doing their thing. And we make our own soil, so we dig turf from the fields around Great Dixter, put it onto these heaps, let it break down, and then put it through a steriliser when it's needed to be used. And we make up our own, well, we don't make up our own mix, but we make it up by hand. We've got three recipes, all invented by John Innes, and we use number two for seed sown. So we've got John Innes number one, two, and three, using our own soil. And we found that the plants do much better growing from our own soil straight into the ground. A lot of plants are growing in a heavy peat soil, and the roots are rather weak. But I will also direct sow. There's my trusty assistant guarding things, and I'm just putting a salad mix in there. And I found, you know, lots of people have suggested lots of things to do this, but I found two hands have worked very well over the years, and I generally have them with me at all times, so I don't have to look for tools. So we just directly sow, follow the string line down, and get the seed in. And there's these said labels at the end of the rows, so we have the same information as we put in the notebook. It'll be interesting though, because someone will stand in front of that label and ask you what is growing in that crop. Some people just like to make conversation. And this is the seedlings ready to be pricked out in their little plastic pots. And they'll move on into plug trays. So they have two stages before they go into the ground. So there they are. We just knock them out into these seed trays and put the individual plants into the individual modules. And I know that there's 99 modules in each tray, so I know how many rows these will cover. So I know what I can calculate where we're going with it and get enough of a crop. And that's what you want to see, this little seedling with this long root ready to go into its own module. This is a lettuce seedling ready to be pricked out and put into the soil. And there they are, there, the rows of them ready to go under glass. So they'll go under glass for a couple of weeks and then they'll go into these cold frames. The thing that people fight, there's two things that the gardeners fight about at Great Dixter. One is water, which seems to be a common thing throughout the world. And the other thing is glass space, having space to get your seedlings growing. So I've moved off-site and I've taken over Mrs. Next Door's glass house. And she's got a much smarter glass house than we do, and I'm the only one that uses it, so I charm her as much as I can and give her free vegetables, and I get to use her glass house in the spring. And these are the cold frames just outside. So that's the wall there, that's the wall to the glass house, and there's the cold frame here. And we open the glass during the day to harden the plants ready for to get out into the garden. And at night we close it down to keep the warmth in. The great thing about having cold frames attached to the glasshouse is also you're going to get heat coming through that brickwork and stop frost getting into your seedlings. Sometimes we do have to still put a fleece layer over the top if it's going to be incredibly cold. And we found that beans have done much better directly sown into plug trays. And these beans are just ready to be got out. You can see at the bottom of the photo there, there's a little white root just peeking out the bottom. They're ready to go into the ground. Beans sulk a lot. They're the teenager of the vegetable world. And the soil's got to be right temperature, and you don't want to have cold nights. Sometimes you'll have to put a fleece over the top of them, but that's the point to get them in the ground. They also don't like it if they can't keep growing, so you've got to keep moving them on. This is a plug tray of kale about to go into the ground, and it's a very easy system. You tilt the plug tray up onto its side and poke in the bottom a little bamboo cane and knock the plants out. And there you've got the seed tray with the plants with this fantastic trowel in the middle of the photo, ready to be planted in the ground. And that's a sign of a good plant. It's holding lots of good soil around it, it's good foliage on top, and it's got a nice root system coming up, so you can see the roots there. It's ready to go on the ground. That's a little lettuce seedling, ready to do its thing. The leeks, it's a different job we do with those. We grow them in 5-inch pots and let them just completely take over the whole pot, and then we tease them out and we put these holes in the ground. You can see the leeks there, and there's these holes here which the leeks are going to be poked into. This, and I think a lot of people at Great Dixter know when I'm planting leeks, because there's a lot of swear words going on and shouting, and because there's nothing more infuriating than doing 25 or something holes and then your dachshund wanting to come and give you some attention and knocking all the soil back into the holes. So it's the time I really do shout at the dogs to get off the garden. But this is what we want to see. We want to see these little seedlings coming out of the ground. And at that moment, we walk down the row with a watering can to fill in a bit of soil. And that stops the birds pecking them out later on, because things like house sparrows like to come and have some greens. And they usually pull out the whole plant. It's also the time to start splitting the artichokes. We've got 4 rows of artichokes at any one time. That was one of the things that Christopher always wanted in the summer. He wanted an artichoke a day. And to get around that, we had 4 rows of them. And I think it's probably his idea to do it like this. We have 4 rows of them. Every year we split 2 of the rows. And then the following year we do the other 2 that weren't done. And the ones that were split will bud up later in the season. The ones that weren't split will bud up first. So that way you get a succession right through the summer. And it's at the moment when the leaves are just starting to the roots are just starting to do their thing that you start splitting them. You've got to wait till that moment, because they're quite tricky on our heavy clay soil. But I'll also grow some in pots. And that I've already had people emailing asking me for artichokes. So I pot up a load of those under glass, and then I can just give them away already growing, which it makes life much easier, because they don't hold very long once out of the ground. So unless people can come immediately, it's not going to work. Forget-me-nots are a great assistant for me. They do the thing I can't do because of time early in the spring. They suppress the weeds. So we've got these rows of forget-me-nots, which are growing into the kale that's all in flower there, but they're completely covering the area. And they'll do that, and we'll pull them out when we've got more time, just after they've started setting seed, because they are prolific. So you don't want the whole garden forget-me-nots. But they are useful in the fruit cage, just to suppress the weeds before you're ready to get to the area. And I try and grow different crops each year. This is a Malabar spinach, which I had no idea was a climber when I sowed the seeds. I think this is also a great time for me to suggest to you as gardeners, read the label sometimes, because you don't know what you're getting unless you do. But I decided to do the fruit cage in a sort of more decorative Burley Mark style of planting, of playing with foliage. And then this little thing did something that I didn't expect. But I watched its development, and I noticed it started putting on these laterals up here. And I thought, well, maybe it wants to climb up something. So I put in canes, and it was fantastic. And it's a very good vegetable to make curries and things out of. I've got a Sri Lankan friend in the village, and she was very pleased to see something that she knew from home growing very well in East Sussex. We don't just, so as I've said, we're either direct sowing or plug plant planting. These two rows here, these are helichrysum, everlasting flowers. Christopher always grew those and put them in the house for the winter just to give some cheer, some bright colours. And so we still grow them today and bring them into the house in the autumn. I much prefer to grow things in plug plants because I'm a control freak. And I hate these gaps in rows. I think it looks bad, it looks messy. But things like dill, you've got not much choice. You could split them up, but they do sulk if you move the roots too much. So I just kind of grin and bear it. The only thing that I don't mind where it grows are these little violas. The other thing I really love, and I don't mind them self-sown throughout the garden. Pumpkins, we grow them in the 5-inch pots. Get them to a decent size. We don't have the same sort of heat as you do in this part of the country, so we need to get them growing under glass, doing their thing before they can be planted out. And it's at that point, you know, all countries import labour for different things. We have Eastern European plumbers who are very good, but it's at this moment I import Americans to plant pumpkins. A couple of years ago we had some Chanticleer gardeners, they came to lunch, and they foolishly asked me if there was anything they could do to help. I said, yes, there is, you can plant the pumpkins. So they rolled up their sleeves and got up there and planted the pumpkins, and they worked quite well. So it was great to have a native doing something like that. I've always hated these white little hoop covers. I've always, since going to Spain and looking, being up in the mountains in the south and looking down on that plain of awful white polytunnels, I thought, I hope we never do that at Great Dixter, and then I came back a few years later and did it. The problem for us in the summer is, for the carrots, is carrot fly. And the only, you've got to completely cover the crop. And so I found polytunnel to work very, these little polytunnels, they're only about that tall. And you know when the vegetable's ready because it's pushed the top off. So as the foliage grows and the root is doing its thing underneath, it starts lifting it up. You know it's at that moment you can start eating and taking it away. But I do find them rather unattractive to look at. But protection is useful in all aspects of life, including gardening. And this is protection from white butterfly in the brassica crops. We grow a lot of kale, and we put these little fine netting on there so we don't have to use chemicals on the vegetables. And the key to that is have big enough frames that the butterfly can't lay her eggs on any foliage. There's no foliage up against the side. It also stops the bastard pigeons from getting to the kale. The bird I detest. They're very nice eaten pigeon breast with salad. And they will get in there and eat all your brassicas. I once planted 300 kale plants, and at the end of the day I thought, okay, in the morning I'll get up and I'll cover them, everything will be fine. Pigeons probably get up an hour and a half before you ever do, and they will go up there and eat your whole crop, as they did mine. So don't go to bed till you've got protection. And you can use that as liberally as you'd like. We also have this fruit cage, which protects the soft fruit from the birds in the summer. And it's a walk-in made with this mesh to stop the birds, because we don't need to cover the autumn raspberries, because there's enough going on in the countryside for the birds not to be hungry. So it's only the summer raspberries we need to cover, and the other soft fruit that flowers then. Also remember, prevention is the best cure. Stake something before it needs to be staked. Also learn that from me. Don't go up there one day and see that your broad beans are on the right angle and are never going to grow straight again. get up there and stake them early, and you're onto a winner. If you leave it too long, it just doesn't work as well. Also, the tomatoes, get the stakes in. We always stake before we put the plants in, so we're not driving a large stake through the root system of the plant. These are chestnut poles as well. The year before I used them for the tomatoes, I saw Ferg had used them for the dahlias, and I thought, they're very nice. And my tomatoes were ready before his dahlias, so I stole them. And that autumn I hid them and have used them ever since. But it's nice to have our own chestnut poles to stake the tomatoes. Pea sticks, this is a byproduct of the woodlands, and there, it's the top of the coppice woods. We use them to grow the peas up, and we, as long as you put in enough poles to hold the pea sticks in place, they work very well. That's another annoying thing, if after a night of hard winds, going up and seeing your peas laying on the ground. We use a tarred twine for most of our crop staking, and that's because it won't rot out in the summer. It holds, and when you plant these tomatoes, they're tiny. You've got to remember they're going to get tall, and they're going to have lots of fruit, God willing. But you need to have good support for them, because they will fall over. The whole row will fall over. This is the Dutch hoe, and it's a very simple, useful. Any simpleton can push a hoe down a row of vegetables. That's what I like about vegetable gardening. It's quite simple. Not that Johnny's a simpleton, but he understands the concept of this is a row of vegetables and this is weeds, which is half the battle when you get help. And there you can cover a large area of ground just hoeing between the vegetables. Water is very important. We all know that, whether it be for humans or vegetables. Like humans, vegetables run to seed if they're not given enough water. And that's the key, is to keep getting the water onto the vegetables. And we probably water every 7 to 10 days. And we use a very simple system. We have a hose with a sprinkler, and we leave it on the same area for an hour, move it after an hour to the next. And that really gets in and soaks deep into the soil, and that'll help the roots to go down. If you're constantly sort of just waving a hose around while thinking about life, your root system will stay near the top. You've got to get the water to penetrate deep, and the roots will do that. Well, they will follow that moisture. There's in the summer, the late summer, the pumpkins are doing their thing, and the meadows are starting to brown off now, getting ready to be cut and made into compost. And this is what we want to see on the heaps. This is a Turk's turban gourd, and we'll use it as a decoration in the house in the winter. We also have to do some pruning of the soft fruit in the summer, and there I am pruning the gooseberries, taking off some of the new wood and just cleaning them up. And I just try and keep the courtyard looking good. Different things with pots, that's the other great thing about pots. You can change things around, you can move the pots around, you can do new combinations. They're much more fun. So it doesn't matter how big your place is, even if it's a window box, you can change it out 4 or 5 times a year and you've still got something interesting to look at. These are black currants. They're not very well known in Britain, really, because the Ribena people take them all to make their juice. But I think it's the best jam you can get, and it's certainly not a jam I would put out for guests. I keep that for myself. It's a very nice, strong flavour, slightly bitter, but great. The horticultural world is a fantastic world, and there's a lot of people in the audience today who I know, and I know professionally and personally. And I've got a great friend, Tom Coward, who works, we were at Kew together. He's now the head gardener at Gravetye Manor and owned by Mrs. Next Door. But he often gives me new varieties that he wants me to try. And this is a fantastic gooseberry. It's a red gooseberry, and it gets quite big, and it's like eating a grape. Unlike the green gooseberries, which you take while they're still slightly bitter, these red ones you take when they're warm and they're big and juicy, and just eat them just like that. And there's these colanders full of black currants. And now's the moment to start thinking about inviting house guests down to halve your workload. Red currant jelly, black currant jam, and raspberries generally are eaten perfect with a bit of cream for breakfast. I think there's nothing quite like it. And there's the image of the autumn raspberries looking tender. The thing Christopher always did was, as soon as it was going to rain, he made sure someone went up and picked all the autumn raspberries, because they will produce mould quite quickly. So if it's going to rain, get up there and collect them while they're warm. This I'd like to show you to prove that we can grow tomatoes in Britain. It's not just in America you can grow them so well. I didn't buy these in for the photo shoot. These were straight from the vine. And we found one that does terribly well for us, a variety called Crimson Crush. It's a good one. It doesn't seem to get blight. Blight is the problem that we will get earlier on. And that's the thing that, you know, your mates as gardeners will come and say, well, how are your tomatoes doing? And judge you as a vegetable gardener. And I've found it's not a great flavor, but you do get a decent amount. And it's perfect for chutney and tarts and things like that. So it's a good doer, not the best flavor, but you can't have everything in life, I've realized. Peas, I think, are a great vegetable for freezing. They freeze incredibly well. They still taste as good as they did as soon as they're picked. The thing about them is, don't pick them too old. Get them while they're young and fresh, and they'll be perfect for freezing. Any vegetables that we have left over that we aren't going to use, we'll sell at the front door. There's chest at the front door, and we just put these things of vegetables out there to sell. And we're not organic, but we try not to use any chemicals. And that's the aim of the vegetable garden. Having these covers and things has helped hugely with that. And having a Dutch hoe has also been good, because you can just hoe the roots off on a sunny day. And we want to cover as much soil as we possibly can. Like the rest of the garden, the more you've got left open, the more weeds will grow. If you cover your area up, you're not going to have a problem with weeds. So that's what we found great. I wanted to just, we're going to now have a look at the cooking side of things briefly. This is a great old recipe. This is Christopher's mother's handwriting. And this is in one of the drawers at Great Dixter in the kitchen. And this is a recipe for tomato puree. And this is pre-refrigeration. So it's 6 pounds of tomatoes with 1/4 pound of salt. Which is a lot of salt. If there's doctors in the audience, they'd be horrified. But I did make it exactly as the recipe says. The problem with it is it's very addictive. I obviously quite like salty things, and so I had to quickly freeze it so I didn't eat it all myself. But it's very good. It's very useful in soups and stews and things if you freeze it in small bags. But it's very interesting to have these old recipes. And there's more of them. There's Christopher's mother's writing again. And there's the ripe tomato chutney. Christopher hated green tomato chutney. And it was always amusing when people would bring him a jar of their prized green tomato chutney. He would put it onto the pantry table, and there it would sit for his housekeeper to take home. Anything Christopher didn't like, he just said thank you and put it on the pantry table. That was an indication he wasn't going to eat it, and he didn't want to see it when he went back through. So there's the old recipe for that. And almond biscuits. The recipe's in the cookbook, but it's been interesting because almond biscuits have followed me on this book tour. I'm not sure why, but everywhere I've seemed to have gone, they've made me almond biscuits, not necessarily for me. I even had to judge a culinary school's almond biscuits. The first lot were awful, and I dreaded sampling the rest, but they got better as I went on. I won't tell you where they were. There's pumpkins, fantastic pumpkins. We don't grow too many of those big ones. It was fun for a couple of years to grow those massive ones, and I used to compete with Mrs. Next Door's gardener for who can grow the biggest pumpkin. It's quite a boy thing to do. But I've gone back to growing these littler ones. More flesh, good flavour, and I found them to be fantastic. and we'll make them into pumpkin pies. I like to make them into, I like to make a pumpkin pie for an American audience to show that their mother wasn't the best pumpkin pie maker. It's quite heartbreaking for some people, I think. We also, this is a salad from my home country of New Zealand. It's kumara and pumpkin salad. Kumara is sweet, translated to sweet potato. It's the native New Zealand word for sweet potato. It's a very good salad, and we really enjoy it. Courgettes. So courgettes are an interesting plant to grow. Unless you've got 12 children, you don't need many plants. And it seems to me that the packets of seeds have about, the packets have about 10 seeds. And when you've got them, you think, oh, well, I'll just plant them all. It's a complete nightmare. I'm a bachelor. Mrs. Nextdoor lives in the country during the week on her own, so we share the crop. One year she'll grow half a dozen plants, another year I'll grow half a dozen plants, and we found that to be a very good system. We still have lots of them. Pick them while they're young, and this is a fantastic soup. This is Mrs. Nextdoor's courgette soup. Very nice, and this is fantastic for before lunch on the terrace on a sunny day with champagne or Dutch gin, with a bit of hummus or something like that. These are courgette fritters, fantastic things. We're also training in espalier pear trees to take over the old ones that, that are getting quite old at Great Dixter. There they are, the young ones up in the vegetable garden. And there's a close-up. We don't use chemicals on them, so they don't look perfect, but they're very, very good flavour, and they store well, and they make a very good tart. There's the pear tart, and they also, this is another Tom Coward gift to me. One evening he was coming for supper, and he bought a jar of his own pickled pears and a block of blue cheese. It was fantastic. The rest is history. I now make them every year myself. And they're such good flavor, you know, good thing to have at the end of supper with a nice glass of wine. And there's the, so the pears are brought into the larder and stored for as long as they last. They don't last a huge length of time because we eat a lot. But there they are again. And I think the genius of Lloyd and Lutyens when they did buy Dixter and take it over was that they didn't knock down all these beautiful old buildings. This is the old fruit store in the nursery. Christopher started the nursery in the 50s and he used part of it. Anyone who's been to Great Dixter will remember this little iconic door into the potting shed and that little white label. And that's his potting shed. And it, I know it looks medieval to a lot of people in this modern country, but we've got things like telephones now and electricity. So we've modernized it and it's working well. And it's also the great place where I will store the potatoes. There's the Picassos and the pink fir apples. And this is the photo that probably tested the relationship I had with Andrew the most, getting him to go into this dark potato store and getting a photo. The shutter speed was incredibly slow, and he had to get up onto some beams above the store. It was an interesting moment. And there's this little viola. I think it's completely charming. I'm probably the least romantic person you'll meet. But these little faces I find absolutely charming. And I love to look at them in the winter when everything else is gloomy. And they are edible, but how could you eat a face like that? I want to end with this slide. Just to remind you, Great Dixter isn't all about vegetables. We have got some pretty borders around the garden as well. So I just wanted to make sure you're not going to be shocked that the whole place isn't under vegetables. It is also a decorative garden. So thank you very much. We have got a bit of time for those who don't want to buy the book can ask questions. No, seriously. Everything's in the book, but if you've got some questions, fire away.
Can I go there?
If you pay and don't complain about the long meadows, we'd be happy to have you. We're 52 miles south of London, down on the south coast, 10 miles. You've probably already been. Yeah, look, it's an interesting subject and not something I really can answer much about. It's a school of thought. It's, you know, some people do that, some people don't. I don't, and I'm not going to sell you any idea. I think you garden how you, it's how we garden. My friend Tom at Gravetye does a lot more of the winter crops in the ground. I could talk for years about it, and I don't know enough about it, so no, I can't help you, sorry. Any other questions? Yes. Hello.
Talk a little bit about your decision to not use raised beds versus using just sowing the seeds and putting the crops flat in the ground, and how you manage footsteps and compaction.
Well, footsteps are easy to deal with. You shout. No, we've got around the vegetable garden has paths, so the public walk around the outside and can look into the vegetable garden. I inherited the vegetable garden. It isn't my design. It's traditional to Great Dixter. It works at Great Dixter. And, you know, the less you walk on soil, the better, obviously. But it's a traditional garden, and the raised beds wouldn't look authentic. It looks as it would have traditionally looked in Britain. You can go to any large vegetable garden. You don't find raised beds. I think they're a suburban thing. What I'm saying is it isn't on large estates. It's a much more smaller scale. And I think they're very useful for your back and for the soil control. But I grow in a very old-fashioned way, I suppose. And that's the way it is. So, yeah. But I don't mind walking around a raised vegetable garden. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, shout. It works.
So I liken you to a modern Harry Johnson, who
Is that a compliment or an insult? You know, I've been called all sorts.
Yeah.
Have you ever made a cookbook? It's bad enough with a photographer. I dread to think what a television crew would be like. I've got to be perfectly honest. I'm a gardener. It's what I want to do. It's what I like to do. I like to be out there just gardening and coming in to cook, you know, when needed. So it's not something I want to... It's not a path I want to follow. But thank you. Someone needs to grow the vegetables. I'm happy to grow for someone else.
Yeah, thank you so much. Way back here.
Oh, yes. Sorry, the lights are so bright.
That's all right. I just would like to know, for whom are you growing and cooking all these lovely vegetables?
Good question.
Yeah. Thank you.
Well, Christopher died 11 years ago this January, and Great Dixter was a very different place then. We've had to evolve. Christopher tried to write a book every winter or thereabouts. He also wrote for 42 years every single week for Country Life. He wrote for the weekly for 17 years for The Guardian. So he had a great income to the place as well as visitors. So when he died, we wanted the place to continue, but we didn't have the funds. And so there was all sorts of things that went on to secure the trust. That it's a private trust now, so we had to fundraise. We did an £8 million project to secure the property. And it was at that point we had to start thinking about doing other events to bring in income. So what we do is we have four symposiums a year. And it was started off through Horticulture magazine, Tom Cooper at Horticulture magazine, and he would bring 12 North Americans to Great Britain, and they would spend a week with Fergus, and I would do the cooking. So that's how that evolved. And then that led on to 14 study days a year. We have one-day study days, Fergus does the lecturing, and I do the cooking. So first and foremost, that's where a lot of, I mean, it's not a massive garden. The whole estate, the whole decorative side of the estate is 6 acres. That's, it's quite small and compact. It's just full on. But, so we use a lot there. We have guests from all over the world come in to stay on personal invitation. It's not a bed and breakfast or a hotel. And I do remind people who don't always remember it's not a hotel. As Christopher said, if you want breakfast in bed, sleep in the kitchen. So we cook for that and, you know, just all that sort of thing. So it's, well, there's a lot going, we have a lot of personal friends, but also ways of making money through these events, which the vegetables are used for. And I'm very seasonal with the book, with the cooking, and that's what I hope the book reflects. The book is written from the point of view of a gardener who cooks, not a cook who gardens. I trained as a gardener, I garden, and the cooking is a secondary part. So I think that's how the book, I hope, is a very practical book for people. It's it tells you about the problems of growing vegetables. So yeah, that's how we use the products. Thank you.
Yeah. How large is your gardening staff? How many people are gardeners there?
Maybe five. Do you mean in the vegetable garden or the whole garden? Maybe six. Yeah, there's six of us. But we have volunteers and we have students. We have about 6 students a year that live on site and help in the garden who are very useful. So yeah. Yeah, it's a small team, but it's effective. Yeah.
I didn't hear how large the developed.
The decorative side of Great Dixter is about 6 acres, so it's not very big in the gardening world, but it's a theatre of excitement.
What?
Ah, okay, we're open. Okay, yes, we're open this weekend, if you can get a quick flight. We're open the 1st of April till the end of October. We have a plant fair this weekend, which I'm missing. Sorry about that. And that kickstarts our season, and then we're open till the end of October. We're not open on a Monday. I don't care how far you've traveled. We're not open on a Monday. Being from New Zealand, I'm not very sympathetic when New Zealanders come and say they've come this far. I say, well, I Google places before I travel. So we're not open on a Monday, but every other day from 11 till 5.
Can you talk a little bit about how you deal with it?
Where are you? Oh, well, stand up.
Can you talk a little bit about how you deal with fungal problems in the garden without spraying too much?
It's not a great problem for us. We don't use fungicides. It's not something we seem to get much of in Britain. I don't, you know, the thing about it is, you get the cleaner the garden, the less you're going to have. You know, it's spacing vegetables out. Lettuces and things will sometimes get it in a very wet summer. They'll get problems with fungus. But I think the key is keep the plants sort of moving and. Yeah, clean and not too close so they can breathe. Yeah. Yeah.
Right here.
Yeah.
First of all, I love your personality. I love the humor.
At least someone does.
That's paradise. I've had a lot of problems with my gardening, specifically chard, broccoli, and squash zucchini.
Yeah.
Bugs, protection. I don't want to use any pesticide, but it just seems that they beat me to the punch. And yeah. I've had these crazy moths that actually go into the squash, they, you know, leave their eggs, and before you know, the squash is absolutely dead at the stem, and it dies off. And I heard about razor blades and cutting in and picking out. And
I think I know what you should do. Move to Britain. It sounds like you're wasted in the States, and it's not working for you. So, I mean, what I've found, I mean, there's a lot of much better gardeners in the room than me who have know your climate, but we cover a lot with insect so they can't get to the crops. But then you've got a sort of unattractive view. But someone like John Gwynn, who's up there, he's the man. He'll help you out. He's much better than me. He's the one with the hat on. I don't know why he's wearing a hat in here. Okay, I think that's enough. And thank you very much.